Joseph on this side. So today hand we are starting with a topic called as organism and population. Okay, so let's get started. So here, starting with the first thing first, we are dealing with the definition of ecology. So basically, ecology is the branch of biology that deals with the interrelationship among the organism and their environment. Okay, I repeat, it deals with the study of interrelationship between the organism and their environment. Here we have different types of the ecology as well. Somehow the first one is called as applied ecology. It is a study of a specialized field of ecology which are related with the conservation and economic exploitation of organism. So what we'll be dealing in the applied ecology? We will be dealing with the conservation and economic exploitation of organism. For example, in the field of agriculture, agronomy, or in the field of the wildlife management somehow. How come? Like we can divide the here. You can divide the biosphere into three phases. The first one will be called as a transition zone, the second one called as the buffer zone, and the third one is called as a core zone. What happens in the transition zone? That no limited human activities allowed. Here you can go for picnic. Correct? Okay. So the transition zone, the outermost zone of our reserved biosphere, limited human activities allowed. In the second zone, here I'll be dealing with that only the Adivasi people or the tribal people can live here. And in the core zone, no human activity is allowed. That is the case of the applied ecology and especially in the wildlife management conservation. The second one is called a system ecology. It deals with the interpretation of ecological concept. Interpretation of ecological concept and processes in the term of mathematical modules of formulae. Okay, deal with. Now, the third one is called as a gene ecology, which is the study of the genetic composition and the change in relation to the origin of echids, ecotype and the new species, the formation of the new species, or somehow. Gene ecology is the basically study of genetic composition of an organism and the changes which are occurring in the genetic composition. Okay, deal with. Now, if I'm dealing ecology, I have to start with the studying of single individual, that will be called an organism. And after studying the single individual, I'll be dealing with the population's study. And the population is making community. Starting again, the individual. Individuals of same species are comprising the population, whereas the population is making the community. Correct? And then we will be going on the larger scale, that is called as ecosystem, then the landscape, then the biome, and at the end of the day, it will be biosphere. Now, dealing with the organism and its environment. So here, the variation in the intensity and the duration of temperature along with annual variation in the precipitation results in the formation of major biome. For example, again dealing with the variation in the intensity and the duration of temperature along with annual variations in rainfall, that is what we call as precipitation. Okay, it is resulting in the formation of major biome, that is called as a desert biome or the rainforest or tundra. Okay, deal with. So here regional and the local variation within each biome are leading to the formation of different kind of habitat like the tropical rainforest, deciduous rainforest, desert and sea coast somehow. Okay, deal with. Now, the abiotic force factors are also playing an important role in the ecology. The first one is called as a temperature. Okay, deal with. So here in case of the temperature, the organism that can tolerate a wide range of temperature are called as eurythermal, whereas the organism which are restricted to a narrow range of temperature are called as stenothermal. Okay, stenothermal. So wide range of temperature, survival will be called, the animals will be called as eurythermal animal, whereas the narrow range of temperature, that will be called as stenothermal. The second abiotic factor is called as water. Here some organisms are tolerant to wide range of salinity in the water and they are called as a eurihaline, whereas some are restricted to the narrow range are called as stenohaline. Okay, deal with. The third one is called as light. So here, flowering in some plant occur only in the presence of critical daylight. I repeat, flowering in some plant occurs only in the presence of critical daylight, and that is what we called as photoperiodism. Hopefully you do know, but still there are three types of the plant will be, that will be called as LDP, SDP and DNP. Correct? Okay, so the LDP needs more than 12 hours of light, whereas SDP need less than 12 hours of light, and the DNP it basically it is not dependent on the amount of the light, like the special time period and something like that. Okay, and that special phenomena that the flowering period is related with the amount of the light which is received and the duration of the light will be called as photoperiodism. The last but not the least, the major abiotic factor is called as soil, in which the soil composition, the grain size and the aggregation determines the percolation and the water holding capacity. Percolation and the water holding capacity of soil. There are different types of soils as well, like yellow soil is there, red soil is there, black soil is there, sandy soil is there, like something like that you can deal with. And the highest water holding capacity is with the black soil. Okay. And there are some other factors as well, something like the pH, the mineral composition and the topography of the soil is determining the vegetation, which type of the plants will be grown in that specific soil. Okay. And there are some responses as well from the organism side to the abiotic factor. And the first one here is called as a regulation, or we'll be calling it as regulate. So here the animals and the birds are capable of maintaining homeostasis, which is the ability for making an equilibrium in the internal body. Okay, internal equilibrium maintenance is called as homeostasis. Okay, by the physiological means, which is ensuring a constant body temperature as well and the constant osmotic concentration as well. Okay, what is the constant body temperature for human? It is 37, whereas a bird is, it is 39 degrees C. Okay, deal with. And the constant osmotic concentration as well, that is the 300 milliosmol. Okay. The human blood osmotic concentration is 300 milliosmol. The second one is called as conform. Most of the animals and the plants, their body temperature changes with the ambient temperature, especially in the aquatic animals. Somatic osmotic concentration of the body fluid changes with that of the ambient water, the osmotic concentration, and these animals will be called as conformers. Okay, what they are doing? They are just changing their body fluid concentration along with the environment. The third one is called as migration. Here the organism move away from the time being. Okay, the organism move away from for time being for the stressful unfavorable habitat to more suitable habitat. Okay, for example, here the Siberian birds are migrating to Keolado National Park, Bharatpur, India. Why? Because they are usually they are in the Siberia in the cold environment, the cold season. Okay, whenever the summer season in entering in the Siberian area, they will be migrating here into the Keolado National Park, because here the again the winter season is starting. So the complete year they will be there in the winter season only. Okay, whenever the summer season is starting at one place, they will be migrating to the other side of the pole where the opposite season is about to start. Now dealing with the suspend, here in the microorganism like the bacteria, fungi and some lower plants are also there, which have a thick wall along their spores. Okay, they will be producing spores, and those spores will be having thick wall, which is helping them to survive unfavorable condition. That thick wall, they produce the spores, thick walled spores, before they die. So ultimately these spores will be mixed with the soil, and whenever the water is coming, whenever the rainfall is occurring and water is coming in contact with those spores, again they will be forming the plumule and the radical, and they'll be forming a proper plant. If they are bacteria, they will be further going for the division and redivision and showing the development. Okay. Now dealing with the adaptation. So here the adaptation is the attribute of organism morphological, physiological and behavioral changes that are enabling the organism to survive and reproduce in the habitat. Specifically in the mammals in the cold climate have shorter ears and limbs to minimize their heat loss. I repeat, mammals in the cold climate have shorter ears and limbs to minimize the heat loss, and this is called as Allen's rule. What does the Allen says? Shorter limbs. And another, like there is another rule as well that is given by the Bergman. And what Bergman is saying, that the animals, that especially the mammals living in the warm area have longer limbs. They have longer limbs. Okay, deal with. Now, starting with the next portion of the chapter called as population. Here the individual of any species living in group in well-defined geographical area, they are sharing and competing for the similar food sources, and they are potentially interbreed, which means they can reproduce. Okay, they can interbreed and they can reproduce a new individual. They are called as population. So the members of same species which can interbreed and reproduce a new individual are called as population. And the population attribute is basically related with the birth and the death rate, natality and mortality, that the number of individuals taking birth per unit area, per unit time. That will be called as birth rate, whereas the number of individuals die per unit area, per unit time will be called as death rate. And these two are very important attribute in the conformation of a population. The second one is the ratio, sex ratio, like the number of the males as with the number of the females. Okay, deal with. Now, here, a population at a given time composed of different individuals of different ages. If the age distribution is plotted for the population, the resulting structure is called as age pyramid. And basically the shape of the pyramid reflects the shape of growth status of population. So ultimately here three basic age groups have designed, that is called as pre-reproductive, okay, reproductive and post-reproductive. I repeat, pre-reproductive, reproductive and post-reproductive. So what I'll be dealing here, okay, so the pre-reproductive will be less than 15 years of age, okay, whereas the reproductive will be 15 to 45 years of age, and the post-reproductive will be more than 45 years of age. Getting? Okay. Now, if the number of the pre-reproductive individuals in a population is more as compared to the post-reproductive, we will be having the pyramid something like in this fashion. Correct? Okay. So this will be the post-reproductive, this will be reproductive, and this will be pre-reproductive. And this type of pyramid will be called as expanding population. Okay? Now, if the number of pre-reproductive and the number of reproductive are same, here we'll be having the pyramid something like this. Correct? Okay. This is post-reproductive, this is reproductive, and this is pre-reproductive. Okay? Done. And if the number of pre-reproductive is less than the reproductive, we will be having the pyramid in inverted shape, something like this. Okay, this will be the post-reproductive, this will be the reproductive, and this is the pre-reproductive. And here, like till now, there are two countries which are showing negative population growth. They are called as Japan and the France. And still, like the another countries, each and every country is showing the expanding population, or what we call as the growing population. Now, how come the population growth takes place? So basically, here the population growth is working in the fashion that the main factors which are determining the population growth will be called as natality, that is the number of birth, mortality, that is the number of death, and immigration and emigration. So natality is basically the number of birth, number of individual taking birth per unit area, per unit time. Okay, per unit area, per unit time. The same is with the mortality as well. And the immigration is somehow, I write immigration in this fashion, entry with an I. And the e-migration I'll be writing as exit, okay, with an E. So e-migration has E, exit also has E, whereas immigration has I, and the entry also has I. Basically in the English language, entry is written with the E, okay. This is just for the convenience, the tips and the tricks which I have used to qualify my exam. I'm just showing and sharing those tricks with you. Now, how come the population density, that is denoted by N, is increased or decreased? So if some individuals are coming here and they are living in this specific location, they are adding the population with the plus symbol. Okay. So the immigration and natality, they are adding the population, in the population, they are increasing the population density, whereas emigration and mortality, they are decreasing the population density. Okay. Now, basically, the immigration and emigration are not of that importance, rather natality and mortality are playing an important role for the structure of the population density, either increasing it or decreasing it in a total settled city. But if a city is newly formed, that time natality and mortality will not playing an important role, rather immigration will playing important role in the increasing population density. Okay, deal with. Now, dealing with the different types of the growth model. Here the growth of population takes place accordingly to the availability of the food, the habit condition, and the presence of the other biotic and abiotic factors. So basically there are two types of model. The first one is called as exponential growth, whereas the second one is called as logistic growth. I'll show you one growth. 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, 512, 102, 420, 46, and 4096, 8112, something like that. The other growth here will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. So ultimately, here if I'll be dealing, both of them are not same. One of them is increasing in exponential manner, correct? And the other one is increasing in the logistic manner or arithmetic manner. This is the case. So here, the growth model, the first growth model is the exponential growth. In this kind of the growth, here the growth occurs when the food and space is available in sufficient amount, or rather I'll be calling it as unlimited amount, theoretically. The population grows in an exponential or geometric fashion, and in this the population size is n, the birth rate is a, b, and the death rate is d. Then the increase and the decrease in the n during period time will be, here I am giving you a derivation where the rate of change of population density with respect to time, that is what we call as the dn by dt, is equal to b minus d into n. Okay, birth rate minus death rate into the proper population density. And let us assume that the b minus d is equal to r, the intrinsic rate of increase, the intrinsic rate of natural increase, or rather I'll be calling it as intrinsic rate of growth. So here the rate of change of population density with respect to time will be equal to rn, intrinsic rate of growth into population density, for exponential growth. The second one is called as the logistic growth. Okay, so here what happens in the logistic growth, there is a competition between the individuals of a population for food and space. Here you will be observing that the interspecific competition is also there, which means that the goat is competing to another goat for the food source, that is grass. And the intraspecific as well, interspecific is the goat and the horse, whereas the intraspecific within the species will be called as a goat and the goat. And here you will be having the carrying capacity as well, that the fittest organism is surviving and reproducing, whereas the unfit organism will be eliminated from the population. That is what we call as a natural selection as well. So in this type of the growth initially shows a lag phase followed by the phase of acceleration and deacceleration. So here a formula will be slightly changed, that the dn by dt is equal to rn k minus n upon k. Now what does this k means? So basically k is nothing but the carrying capacity. Okay, k is nothing but the carrying capacity. So what happens here in the carrying capacity, which means if there is a classroom which has the carrying capacity of 50 students. So ultimately, whenever the 10 or 20 or 30 students are coming, they will be having a lot of options to sit wherever they want. But still, let's say for example, if 60 students have come, only 50 will get their place. And the 10, they will be eliminated somehow. Okay, deal with. There's a graph as well for both of them. The exponential shows J-shaped curve, whereas the logistic shows a shaped curve. Okay, this is for the exponential, which means Rn, correct? And this is for the logistic second one, that is Rn k minus n upon k. Okay, deal with. Now this is the population density in the abscissa and the time t in the ordinate. Done. Okay, so the first one is the J-shaped exponential growth curve is J-shaped, whereas the logistic growth curve is S-shaped, or rather we call it as sigmoid as well. Okay, go through. Now the population interaction here. So basically the population interaction is of different type, that is called as the predation, competition, parasitism, mutualism, commensalism, something like that. Okay, here there are three basic denotions, plus, minus, and zero. So what happens in the minus, the organism is harmed. Whenever the organism is harmed, we will be denoting it as by minus. Whenever the plus, whenever the organism is benefited. Okay, whenever the organism is benefited, we'll be calling it as plus. And zero is neither harmed nor benefited. Okay, deal with. Now starting with the first, that is called as mutualism. It is a type of interaction in which both the partners are getting benefited, plus plus. For example, the best example here is lichen. The best example is lichen, in which we have two partners, algae and the fungus. Algae is giving the food source, whereas the fungus is supplying the shelter. Okay, there is another example of mutualism as well in the NCERT book, that is called as the mycorrhiza and the angiosperm plant. The mycorrhiza and the angiosperm plant, in which the mycorrhiza is supplying the phosphorus, is absorbing the phosphorus from the soil and supplying it to the angiosperm or higher plant, whereas the angiosperm is giving the carbohydrate to the mycorrhiza. In the second interaction, here we are observing the competition in which both the partners are getting harmed. This is basically the inter-specific competition. Okay, deal with. Now dealing with the predation. So what happens in the predation? One of the partner gets benefited, the other partner is harmed. I'll be just dealing with slightly a next as well, because those are contrasting. There's the parasitism. This is also the same. One of the partner gets benefited, the other partner is harmed. So what is the basic difference between the predation and the parasitism? So in case of the predation, it is a tiger and the deer, which means tiger is killing the deer. So they are feeding on the prey just once, only once. Once tiger will attacking on the deer and it will feed, it will leave the tiger's body. Okay? But in case of the parasitism, parasite never kills its host. Rather, it feeds on its host continuously till the life of the host. That is the main difference between the predation and the parasitism. Predation is like one time feeding only, whereas parasitism is continuous feeding. Okay? In case of the parasitism, there are two types of parasites as well. They are called as the ectoparasites and the endoparasites. In case of the endo, you'll be observing like the Plasmodium is there, liver fluke, Fasciola hepatica is there, Wuchereria bancrofti is there, Ascaris lumbricoides is there, and another different helminths as well. But in case of the ectoparasites, we'll be having head louse, tick, leech, and something like that. Okay? Go through. Now dealing with the commensalism. So here the commensalism is the type of the interaction in which one of the partner is getting benefited, the other partner is getting not affected. That is what we call it as neither benefited nor harmed. And the example for the commensalism is orchid on the mango. It is orchid on the mango. The example for commensalism is orchid on the mango. Okay? Whenever orchid is an epiphyte which is living on another plant, so like there's no like harm in mango plant, but still the orchid is getting grown on the mango. So orchid is getting the nutrient from the mango, but still that is not at all any problem for the mango tree. Okay. Another example is also that is called the remora fish and the shark, in which the remora fish are near shark, and whenever the shark is having food, they will be also having food, and that is not affecting shark at all. The last but not the least one is called as amensal or the amensalism. Here what you will be observing in case of the amensalism, one of the partner get harmed and the other partner will get not affected. Here like you will be having example as like the elephant in the forest. Whenever the herd of the elephant is going somewhere, they will be just removing the trees from their original location and throwing it away. So somehow they are just doing it for enjoyment purpose or something like that. But still, that is taking the life of that plant or tree. Correct? So, one of the partner is getting harmed. Here it will be the tree. And the other one is neither harmed nor affected. That will be the elephant. The another name for the amensalism is also there called as allelopathy. It is allelopathy. And what happens here in the allelopathy? In allelopathy, there are some plants which are releasing toxic chemicals to kill the pest or the insects. Insect pest. Okay? But the issue here will be that many useful insects will also killed. Okay? Useful insects will also killed which are not intended to give any harm to the plant, but still they are killed, in which like they are harmed and the plant is not affected. Done? Okay. So this was all about the organism and population. I'll keep uploading the one-shot lectures. Please do support as you are supporting. Thank you. Thank you very much for your so much support. Please ask me any questions as well there in the comment section. Okay? Thank you.